I am Corey Shockey, the Deputy Director General of the International Institute for Strategic Studies, and this is Sound Strategic, our house podcast to celebrate the work and the talent of our research team. And I have the great pleasure to have with me today Dr. Lucy Burrosudro, who is a defense economist in our military analysis team, defense and military analysis team. She did her PhD at an unpronounceable but prestigious French university in Paris called Assas. And she was an analyst for the French Ministry of Defense and now runs defense economics for the Military Balance Program here at the IISS. Lucy, thank you so much for taking time away from your actual work to talk with me today.
Thank you very much, Corey.
So as our listeners know, we have a regular format of questions that we ask people. And the first one is going to be so much fun to ask Lucy because her actual research is what is all over the news these days. So Lucy, tell our listeners which of your research is all over the news these days.
Thank you, Corey. So as you mentioned, my PhD was on arms exports. I studied French and Swedish arms exports. So I tried to keep an eye on the issue of arms sales around the world in my work at the Institute. And what has been quite newsworthy in this area is the war in Yemen and arms sales to countries who participate in the war in Yemen. This has been very much over the news since the Saudi intervention started in 2015, as sales of military equipment to countries who are involved in this war has become more and more controversial. And this is controversial because the coalition countries who intervene in Yemen have been accused of violating international humanitarian law. And actually, arms exports are regulated by international treaties, which theoretically prohibit sales to countries who violate international humanitarian law.
So I know that in my own country, the American Congress is up in arms on this count. Which other countries will have to reconsider their arms sales to the coalition of countries fighting in Yemen? Britain, presumably. Who else?
There are many European countries who have started to reconsider their arms sales to Saudi Arabia or the United Arab Emirates or Egypt in the context of the war in Yemen. So this started really by the European Parliament, who produced a resolution saying they would want to see an embargo against these countries. So those resolutions aren't binding, but you've seen a number of countries trying to go along those lines. You've had the Netherlands, Belgium, where Flanders and Wallonia actually have their own export control systems, but the two regions have adopted such restrictions. Germany, of course, and most Scandinavian countries. And in the UK, you've actually had a legal decision telling the government to review or to seize its licenses to Saudi Arabia and its partners and to review its export control processes. Although there is an appeal at the moment, but you can see that there's a trend going that way.
Yeah. So in your work, you look at European-wide arms sales. Mm. How does this patchwork of different regulations get resolved? I'm thinking in particular of how do European countries band together on common arms sales projects if one or another country can each want to opt out in specific cases. What's the solution to that problem?
So there is already a common instrument, which is called the common position adopted by the EU in 2008, which sets a list of 8 criteria that countries are supposed to go through when they authorize export licenses for their defense companies. However, the interpretation of those criteria very much remains in the hands of the different states. And that's why you see different export behaviors from European countries. So this is a problem when, you have joint development programs. So you want to export, so you have different countries who export the same system. They have to agree on common rules. And for the past 20, 30 years, it has pretty much worked. But now this issue is becoming so inflamed and so much on the top of the news that the divergences are saying to be too strong. So how do you go beyond this? There are different solutions that can be discussed. I think one way would be to devolve more powers to the European Union. So you have this kind of extra supranational entity that would enforce more guidance on the different countries, mm-hmm. and therefore centralize the decision making a little bit better.
And do you think that mechanism is adequately strong to bridge the differences between, for example, France and Germany? Because what I took away from your PhD dissertation is the fact that the French have a very almost industrial policy of arms sales in a way that I struggle to see Germany ever being comfortable with. Will giving the power to the EU give Germany enough distance from the decisions, you think, that it can be politically salient?
I think there is the devolution to, well, more devolution to the EU is more advocated by Germany, actually, and France opposes this. So the two positions are that France, or the French defense establishment and defense industry, really doesn't want any more power given to the EU because they want to retain sovereign decision making on this. Whereas from the German perspective, it actually pushes the responsibility of taking a decision a bit further apart. I think actually this could be a common ground. This could be a middle ground between the two countries, where you have France maybe applying a bit more restrictions, and Germany maybe being a bit more, going more for consensus with its European partners on this issue. So it could actually be a way for the two countries to meet in this direction.
Excellent. So how did you get interested in this kind of work? What makes you a defense economist?
So I started working on this with my master's dissertation, so that's almost 10 years ago now, which is always a bit painful to admit.
No, because look at the excellent body of work you have done in the meantime. You're looking at that all wrong, my friend.
Let's look at the experience, yeah. So I started with this in 2010 with my master's dissertation, which led me to an internship at SIPRI, which is the Stockholm International Peace Research Institute. They work on a database on arms transfers, and I did an internship with the team there, which then led me to stay in Sweden and work on controversial weapons production, so anti-personnel mines, cluster munitions, nuclear weapons.
Just to be clear, you were analyzing those issues. You weren't actually working on those weapon systems.
No, I was analyzing the production of those weapons, production and sale of those weapon systems. So trying to identify companies around the world who were involved.
Because I was going to be super impressed if you were a munitions maker and nuclear engineer, and that I never knew that about you.
Yeah, I never knew that about myself. So, that's what I did for a bit, and then moved on to PhD, and now here I am.
Talk a little bit about your PhD dissertation, because you are right now transitioning in that stage. Every postdoc has been transitioning your dissertation into a book. Yep. and give a summation of what you learned looking at the comparison of Swedish and French arms exports.
Thank you for that question, because it's always also good to move back to the Swedish case a little bit, as I've been focusing on France those past few years. I think the comparison really allowed me to see what are the factors that influence decision making in terms of arms export policies. And I think what explained, in short, the big difference between France and Sweden having a bit more restrictive position on this issue, is really the strength of civil society involvement and parliamentarian control. So what you've seen in Sweden is a very, very active civil society movement, a very strong NGOs, very involved in this issue, which wasn't the case so much in France. And in Sweden, the parliament is actually involved in the export control process for arms sales, which is also the case in the US, actually, interestingly. But in France, the parliament doesn't have a strong role, whereas in Sweden, parliamentarians have their say on to whether or not to authorize or deny an export license. Mm-hmm. So I thought those two elements were interesting mechanisms to see why it was more restrictive in one way or another.
And so I, being a political scientist, always love these questions about the conditions that make a country reliable or unreliable. Mm-hmm. And when we are talking about the difference between committing between authoritarian governments or liberal governments. Mm. The general rule of thumb is that democracies are slow to commit, but more durable in commitment. Because so if you can get a commitment out of a democratic country, it's more likely to be sticky. It's more likely to hold over time and under pressure than a commitment from an authoritarian government, which is more easily given. But because it doesn't have civil society and public buy-in, because they don't have to go through the process of building public support, they tend to be easier to break. Is there any parallel to that in arms sales? Like, would France be a preferential arms supplier because you don't have to have parliamentary and NGO involvement? Or would Sweden more likely to be a reliable supplier of essential weapons to a country because if you can get an agreement with Sweden, it's likelier to be sticky and to hold over under pressure?
In this particular area, I think it's actually, or the way arms suppliers are perceived, you're right. Like, France would be seen as a more reliable supplier than Sweden, but because Sweden does attach conditions to its arms sales the way that France doesn't. And that is actually a problem for what we were discussing earlier about how to gain consensus on the European stage, because what prevents France from moving towards Germany or moving towards a more European solution is because they are very much attached to that notion, to that argument that they are a reliable arms supplier. Mm-hmm. And if they do change this position, it will undermine their one of their main sales arguments on the global arms market. Yeah. So overturning this is going to be very complicated.
That's so interesting. Thank you for that education. So my next question is, what is your favorite book in your field of expertise?
So I don't know if it's my favorite, but it was the most useful thing for me. I mean, it's not a novel or anything. So.
Okay, fair enough.
But it's called Arms in the State, Patterns of Military Production and Trade by Keith Crowles. So published at Cambridge University Press in 1992. And I think what was really useful for me in this book, and I think which is useful to any person who wants to study the arms trade and understand the dynamics of the arms trade, is that he developed a framework to explain the patterns of arms production and sales, which holds over time. So even though his book was published at the end of the Cold War, you can still apply it today. And I think that's really important in an academic book, because sometimes, you know, analytical frameworks, they are developed for very, very specific case studies that the author has been doing, and it's rarely applicable or reusable in other instances. But I think what Crowles managed to do is to have this very endurable framework that we can apply. So I can go into the details.
Say the name of the book again.
So it's called Arms in the State, Patterns of Military Production and Trade.
Excellent. Yeah, tell me more about it.
So what he's done is trying to, his framework is based on two aspects. So first, what are the motives for making and producing arms? So it's rather unsurprisingly wealth, power, and victory in war. And what are the mechanisms for the diffusion of military technologies across the globe? And from there, he developed the pattern of to explain the rise and fall, so to speak, of arms transfers of certain technologies. And you can, if you like, take the example of the drones, for instance, in military campaigns, if you look at his pattern, his framework, you can actually apply that. So first, a cycle of arms transfers begins when you have a new technology that's applied for new warfare use. So people realize, oh, actually this, I can apply it to win wars, so let's do this. Which leads to early adopters and emergence of centers of innovation.
And he came up with this in 1992?
That was...
Was he using the language of early adopters?
I think that's my reinterpretation.
I was going to be super impressed because I think of that so much as a term that only comes of age in the last 10 years.
I think it's my reading and my way of like
explaining. Explaining. It's a good way to explain it.
To re-explain it rather than just reading you the book at the microphone. then you have early adopters who start producing and using those weapons in war, which leads to a gap in different states' capabilities, right? Some states do have that new capability and some states don't. And the states who don't have it say, oh, can I actually buy it? Which creates a demand push and a market for those new types of weapons. And then you have those suppliers or early adopters. Some of them might see a gain, an economic gain in exporting, which creates also a supply push in the arms trade. And at the same time, you have states who will try to retain their technological advantage and won't be willing to export. And as time progresses, you have more and more states who have this capability to build the weapon systems, which leads to a decrease in the trade of that technology. So I think if you look at the UAV, for instance, we might still be in the middle of the second phase for the moment, with still a gap in technology, but still that technology being more and more diffused.
Right. So Yeah. It's so diffusing really fast.
Yeah.
Which will mean you won't have as much arms trade in it, because they'll be domestically produced
by
users.
Yeah.
Interesting. Okay, so where is the conventional wisdom in your field wrong?
So I think it relates to what we were saying earlier at the start of this podcast, of this recording, which is the debate on the European defense cooperation, in particular in the arms field, and in particular the Franco-German arms export debate. So I think the way this issue is usually presented is that Germany is the blocking state in that discussion, because Germany is seen as too dogmatic in wanting to stop arms sales to Saudi Arabia. I argue that it's France that is being too dogmatic.
Really?
Yeah, because they don't want to question at all their way of their arms export policy. But actually, as we were saying earlier, France is becoming more and more isolated, so they are becoming the blocking state in that debate. Netherlands, Flanders, Wallonia, Germany, Scandinavian countries have started imposed restriction on arms sales to the Gulf. As we said, in the UK, there's now a legal decision that has stopped, at least temporarily, licenses. So France is pretty much more and more isolated in this issue.
So if I understand you, France's position hasn't changed. Mm. Germany's position hasn't changed. What has changed is that Germany now commands the majority of European attitudes. That is, Germany hasn't moved, France hasn't moved. The rest of Europe, though, is swinging towards the German view.
Yeah.
And that makes France the blocking vote, because they want to continue arms sales to Saudi.
Absolutely. So I think that's the way we should see the situation now. And I think for France, they're really in a dilemma, in a bind there, because the political discourse is towards more European defense cooperation. But as long as they don't budge on this issue, they're going to hamper more the development of a new weapons program in cooperation with their partners, even though they say they want to do it. So I say that's how we challenge the conventional view in that field.
That is really interesting. We need to limber ourselves up enough to understand that even if we are right about the views we ascribe to the governments of France and Germany, that they're not...
In isolation.
That even if the views don't change, they don't exist in isolation.
Absolutely.
And we tend to conflate those two things.
And this is becoming even more important, because there are new initiatives at the EU level to develop weapon systems with EU money, which may lead in time with the EU, as in the institutions, the commissions, the parliament, becoming involved in export control issues. So unless France's budgets a little bit, it will become complicated to implement those initiatives, which it has itself promoted. So I think it's really tricky for the French at the moment.
Ah, that is interesting. They're sailing between Scylla and Charybdis on that. How about your favorite work that you have done, or some that you particularly want to showcase? And if you don't choose the one I'm thinking of, I'm going to add an additional one.
I think we're thinking about the same thing here. So that's good. I'm in agreement with my boss, so that's a good point for me, I guess. So something I'm really proud of is the work I've done with my colleague, Maya Nawans. So she's our research fellow for Chinese defense policy and military modernization. What we've done together is... researching how much revenue Chinese defense groups derive from their arms sales, from their defense sales. So we've published in an academic journal, and our results have been used by Defense News in their top 100 defense industry. So just to try...
Being nearly expansive enough about the splashy impact this has had. So for listeners who aren't aware, Defense News publishes an annual list of the top 100 defense firms in the world by revenue. And they had not included Chinese firms because the Chinese don't publish any data that gives anybody a sense of reliability about where they would fit. And smart, sparkly Lucy and Maya came up with a methodology for assessing China's the value of China's defense firms, got it validated by publishing the methodology in a Journal of Applied Economics, and then did the analysis of the firms such that was of such persuasive value that Defense News now includes Chinese firms. So brava, it's fantastic work. Explain the substance of it to us.
Absolutely. So this started by actually a frustration. as a researcher who works with data, when I used Defense News or CPRI's top 100s, and the fact that there was no Chinese firms in there, this is, as an analyst who needs numbers and trends and spreadsheets, if you don't have this, you know there's a massive gap in the data and it's a flaw in your analysis.
Okay, so I am drawing hearts in the air because we here at the IISS love ourselves best in data, right? It's the foundation of what we do and how we keep ourselves honest about our analytic judgments. So hearing Lucy's description of her aggravation about this just delights me. Go on. Dr. Burasudro.
So to try to remedy to this, what Maya and I did was very long research going through hundreds of Chinese company websites. What we're trying to assess is what a proportion of defense production those companies were doing. Because what you have to know is that in the Chinese defense industry, we say defense industry, but actually they do all sorts of things and a lot of civilian production or dual use production. So a lot of the work was trying to understand what they were
doing.
So
wait a minute, that's not unique to Chinese companies, right? Boeing builds civilian aircraft.
Of course.
So that wasn't the unique feature of them.
No. The difference is that Boeing publishes figures that allows us to say X percent is civilian, X percent is military, which the Chinese don't do.
Right. And that's what you figured out how to do.
Absolutely.
How?
So by going through hundreds of subsidiaries, I'll just start back, but there are 8 major defense groups in the Chinese defense industry, defense conglomerates, with each of them have hundreds and hundreds of subsidiaries. So we've gone for the mid-level of subsidiaries. So we, instead of going through thousands, we've went through hundreds to try to identify what type of productions they were doing. So either defense or civilian or a bit of both. And from there, we could get a percentage of where we derived a percentage of the total revenue of the conglomerates that were defense or not. So we did estimate those numbers, and we could say for those big conglomerates, what was the proportion they derived from defense in their total sales. So they're still far behind big companies like Lockheed or Boeing, but they're not that far behind that we can say that in 5 or 10 years they'll be at the top.
Absolutely, and they are, if I recall your work correctly, they sell things like UAVs in abundance that we are much more hesitant about the diffusion of technology that you were talking about a couple of answers ago.
Absolutely, that's right.
And my last question, what is your favorite data visualization, Lucy?
So it's a video, a flow map of U.S. versus Russian arms exports in historic trends. So it's actually something I found on the website of a data scientist called Will Geary. So he made a couple of videos using arms transfers data from CPRI to show the flows of arms sales from countries to another. So there's this one where you see you have the U.S. arms sales in blue and the Russian arms sales in red from 1950 to today. And it's quite interesting because you see both the evolution of the arms market, so where are the biggest buyers, but also where the two countries were competing for influence throughout the Cold War and after. And also it's
so it's who they sell to.
Who they sell
to. It's not just market-driven.
No, absolutely. It's who they sell to. So. And it's really made in a way that's quite nice to look at and also quite informative. So I think it's a great data visualization, and I recommend you look at it.
Fabulous. Well, we will post the link to that along with this audio. And I will also post the link to the Defense News ranking that talks about your and Maya Nguyen's sparkly research, and to the research itself, which is, I got to admit, rough sledding for an amateur like me, but super important. And so I want to thank you for teaching me stuff that I had to learn from your research. I want to thank you for your excellent work for the IISS. Lucy, Dr. Lucy Burrows-Sudreau just taught us about arms sales in Yemen, the difficulties of getting a common devolution to European authority on arms sales, because contrary to the conventional wisdom, it's not Germany that's holding up a consensus. It's France as a holdout against everybody else that's holding up. And Arms and the State, a book all of us should read if we want to understand the way technology and arms markets diffuse and develop. And also Will Geary's Flow of Arms Sales, the link to which we are going to post alongside this. Dr. Lucy Burrows-Sudreau, thank you so much for teaching me and our listeners about the work you do.
Thank you, Corey.